Welcome to the Unit 7 Content Overview, Global Conflict in the 20th Century. The essential question for the entire unit is, what was the relative significance of the causes of global conflict from 1900 to the present? And as we saw on the previous slide, as you might know, we're primarily focusing on the two world wars when we talk about one and two. And obviously, since the word causes is here, this is going to be a causation question. Just a reminder about the way this unit is organized. So here's our two central global conflicts in these two chapters. So you can look at the first couple of chapters as being causes of World War I. And then we have some intervening events in the interwar period, which collectively are the causes of World War II. And then we have effects of mass atrocities. And we'll look at this cause and effect relationship again at the end of the video. So starting with 7.1, we look at shifting power after 1900. And this is probably the least directly related to this global conflict, although there is a connection. And we see four countries, Russia, China, the Ottoman Empire, and Mexico, who've had significant political changes. And we're going to look at why that happened. And we're going to sort them by internal and external causes. And we'll look at that when we get to the essential question. Russia has the world's first communist revolution. At first, the monarchy falls and is replaced by a provisional government. Because of some of these reasons of political oppression, the economy was weak, largely because Russia was late to industrialize, and they had some military defeats. And after a period of time with the provisional government, it was replaced by the communist revolution led by Lenin. In China, we have the fall of the monarchy for the first time in China's long history. And that is also due to political and economic weakness and loss of land and things like the Opium Wars. And Sun Yat-sen led a revolution to create a Western-style government, and that was replaced by a communist revolution in 1949, and we'll look at that in the future. We looked at the Ottoman Empire's collapse in an earlier unit, and its final collapse happens during this time period because the Ottoman Empire was on the losing side in World War I, and their empire is broken up and replaced by the modern nation of Turkey. And the Ottomans were weaker than the European rivals, and some independence movements, such as Greece, helped to weaken them as well. And then in Mexico, we have a 1911 revolution driven largely by resistance to Western influence. We've looked at economic imperialism in a previous unit. And the 1911 revolution creates socialist economic policies such as redistributing land. So we can sort these causes again by internal and external. So here's a review of those four areas. And we're looking at things that were problematic inside the country, such as economic strength. And then external would primarily be military defeats, or in the case of Mexico, economic imperialism, such as the influence of the United Fruit Company. So now's a good time to stop and answer this essential question right here. Moving on to 7.2, the causes of World War I, we're going to sort those into two types, long and short term. So the immediate cause of World War I is the assassination of the Archduke Franz Ferdinand of Austria. Serbian nationalists from this part of Europe were concerned about the spread of Austria-Hungary. It had recently taken over Bosnia, which is over here in this region. And in Sarajevo, during a military parade, a nationalist group called the Black Hand assassinated the Archduke and his wife. And this triggered a conflict between Austria-Hungary and Serbia. And that could have been the end of that conflict, but these long-term causes made a conflict between two countries into a world war. And this acronym MAIN is a good way to remember them, because we have militarism, alliances, imperialism, and nationalism. So the fact that countries had large armies created tension between them and made military solutions to problems more likely. Alliances, as we can see here on this map, cause countries to be dragged into a conflict. So if Austria-Hungary is fighting against Serbia, so is Germany. And Russia is going to be concerned about the influence of Austria-Hungary, so they'll declare war, which means Germany will declare on Russia, etc. Imperialism, some of the tension in Europe was caused by conflict between European powers over imperialist ambitions, such as France and Germany having a conflict in Morocco. And nationalism causes countries, especially citizens of countries, to support aggressive actions on behalf of their nation. So the way World War I turns global is that conflict triggered the alliances, which brought all these European powers into the conflict. So now's a good time to stop and use this chart here to look at the causes of World War I. And we'll look at that idea of long and short term. The essential question asks for causes and consequences. There's a list of some consequences here. In Europe, World War I is essentially the fall of monarchies. Some of the maps of colonial empires are redrawn, and we'll look at that in the next section. The economic and social cost is high. We'll look later on at the rise of fascism and the fact that global power is shifting to the United States, and that will be more in future sections. Moving on to 7.3, we are looking at how the war was conducted. And the two things we'll focus on here are new technology and strategies, plus this idea of total war. So here's an example of some of those new technologies. Here's trench warfare in action. Collectively, these technologies account for the staggeringly high casualties of World War I. Trench warfare in particular is a problem because this stalemate meant that, as you can see here, it was hard for soldiers and armies to move, and so they were exposed to enemy fire, and there was a lot of attrition and death without a lot of movement, and the war just kind of dragged on for years. The other thing we see to the greatest extent so far in World War I is this idea of total war, in which an entire population is involved in waging the war. In some cases, that's an economic involvement, such as new labor patterns with women working in factories because men are off fighting. The fact that colonial empires used migrant labor from their colonies to either work in factories or fight in the war. And governments managed the economy to ensure that the war had enough resources, such as rationing food or supplies. And then we have a more political involvement, which is propaganda. Here's an example of an anti-German propaganda poster. And this is designed to create support for the war and appeals to that sense of nationalism. And the other thing to keep in mind about World War I is, although the fighting was primarily based in Europe, it did spread beyond Europe, especially in Asia, with Japan joining the Allied side. And as we mentioned earlier, colonial subjects fighting in European armies. So here's a review of those methods governments used to fight World War I, and we sorted them by types of strategies and new technology. Before we jump to 7.4, I just want to check in about the Treaty of Versailles, which wasn't really addressed by the essential question, but is very important. There was a conflict among the Allied powers who won World War I over what sort of philosophy should be used to govern the peace agreement. And that is essentially split into two. The French wanted to punish Germany, and the United States wanted to focus on peace in the future. And that conflict primarily existed because of the different experiences of those two countries. You know, the United States having joined the war only a year before it ended and without any fighting directly on its territory, had fewer casualties and less damage to its economy than France did. And at the Treaty of Versailles conference, on the whole, France won out. And the treaty blamed Germany for the war and reduced Germany's military only. And Germany had to pay money to the Allies. And this focus of the blame on Germany is going to be important in terms of the rise of fascism later. In 7.4, we look at the economy in the interwar period, and of course, the Great Depression is the primary economic event between 1918 and 1939, and it caused countries around the world to question the laissez-faire system of capitalist industrialization, which had been what drove that process of industrialization. But after the stock market crash, people began to think that maybe this hands-off system was not going to work long-term. And so the big takeaway here is governments began to take a more active role in the economy. This list here is sorted, as we have up here, in increasing amounts of government intervention. So capitalist countries, which maintain the basic principles of capitalism, to a certain extent abandon the laissez-faire system and adopt Keynesian economics, in which government spending is used to encourage economic growth. And the New Deal in the United States is an example of that, as an attempt to get the United States out of the Depression. In Mexico, remember, after the revolution, they embraced some socialist reforms. The PRI is the main political party in Mexico at this time, and nationalizing or having the government run the oil industry is an example of that. And then, of course, in communist countries like the Soviet Union, we have Stalin's five-year plans, in which there is almost complete political control of the economy. We also get in this time period the rise of fascism, and the economic troubles in Europe from a combination of the World War I effects and also the Great Depression make it easier for fascists to be popular in Europe. So the essential question said, how do governments respond to economic crises? And as we said earlier, this is the big takeaway. And these bullets here are in that same order from least to most government involvement, but really everybody's involvement goes up a certain amount. In 7.5, we'll look at unresolved tensions after World War I and the importance of nationalism. As the Americans entered the war, Woodrow Wilson made a claim that the war was being fought to help ensure the principle of self-determination, meaning that everyone should be able to determine their own government. And a lot of colonial subjects in European empires and places like Africa and Asia saw the end of World War I as an opportunity for self-rule. Unfortunately for them, at the Versailles Conference, those claims were rejected. There were some examples of self-determination, but in general, they were rejected. So if you look at the former Ottoman Empire in the Middle East, the mandate system shifts control from the Turks to various European powers. And we have these ideas of mandates. So we have the British and the French mandate, for instance, in what is modern-day Syria, what is modern-day Israel. And this intensifies resistance to colonialism. And Gandhi in India is an example of that, as is Leopold Senghor in French West Africa. And Unit 8 will look at those resistance efforts intensifying. In Asia, we have a similar situation in which Japan is replacing former Western control in Asia. So we have the Greater East Asia Co-Prosperity Sphere, and Japan is extending its control over places like the Korean Peninsula during this time period. And of course, that's going to come up later when we get to World War II. So the essential question asked how continuities and changes caused tensions after World War I. So we'll look at what the continuities and changes were, and then if you were answering this question in a complete essay, you would explain in your analysis why they caused tension. So some continuities, as we said earlier, are imperialist control continues, and that is despite the expectation of self-determination. So that tension is created by the nationalism of the people living in the empire. So for instance, a driving force for Gandhi's protest movement is Indian nationalism. So when we have changes in territorial holdings, it is essentially from one colonial power to another. So the Ottoman Empire, which had controlled much of the Middle East, that control is replaced by other European powers controlling them in the mandate system. In 7.6, we'll look at the causes of World War II, and we'll focus on Europe and Asia separately. The rise of fascism, of course, is the driving force for the start of World War II, and as we said earlier, that's inspired by lingering effects of the Great Depression and tension over the Treaty of Versailles. In the case of Germany, for instance, Germany's militarism and expansion both makes Hitler more popular in some circles in Germany, and also put some pressure on Western powers to stop him. And you look in 7.6, if you go back and look at it, at the failure of appeasement. And with Hitler's non-aggression pact and the invasion of Poland, the war begins. So it was the invasion of Poland that inspired Britain and France to finally declare war on Germany in 1939. In Asia, Japan continues to expand that empire, and its attack on Pearl Harbor in 1941 brings the U.S. into the war. And that is the official start of World War II in Asia, although most scholars would say that it began in Asia with Japan's invasion of China in the 30s. The central question asks for consequences, and an immediate consequence is anti-Semitism in Germany and the Holocaust, but we'll look at some of those in future chapters. So here's that essential question about the causes and consequences. So here's that overview of what the causes were. And we'll start with this chapter on anti-Semitism. And we'll look at casualties, genocide, and new political alliances in future chapters. So for 7.7, as we'll see in a minute, the essential question has to do with the methods of fighting the war. But the video, if you want to look at the 7.7 video, takes some time to look at some of those key events. And essentially, you can sort them, of course, by the European and Pacific theaters. But also, you can kind of look right about here and make a dividing line at which the Axis powers, remember that's Germany, Italy, and Japan, are essentially their fortunes are rising up until roughly this time period. And after this time period, their fortunes are declining. And so the war ends with the Allied victory over the Axis powers. So the 7.7 video goes into some of these key battles and events in more detail. So just to check in about the comparison of the methods of fighting the war. Some similarities, all countries use propaganda to a varying degree, such as this famous US poster here. They all appeal to nationalism, and they all have a certain degree of managing the economy. Some differences between democratic and totalitarian governments are the degree of control over the economy. So in the United States, for instance, some automaking plants like Ford plants were converted with the support of the government to make parts for airplanes or battleships. In the totalitarian countries, we have more total control. There was a program called Gold for the Fatherland in which people sent in their wedding rings to be melted down for the war effort. In democratic countries, the political method of gaining support for the war tends to be to appeal to a sense of freedom and responsibility for others, which is fitting with democratic principles, while totalitarian countries tend to repress basic freedoms in the interest of controlling the war effort. In 7.8, we look at mass atrocities. And there are several examples, starting with the Armenian genocide in World War I, going through the famine in the Ukraine under Stalin, of course the Holocaust in Nazi Germany, the Japanese invasion of China, the Allied firebombings and atomic bombs, and after World War II, ethnic cleansing or genocide in Bosnia, Rwanda, and Sudan. And there's a central question, which is who determines what is a genocide and what is collateral damage in war? So the Allied powers would say that this method of military attack was necessary. There are members of the Turkish government who said that the Armenian genocide was a natural byproduct of war. So that's a question that the world is grappling with in the auspices of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, is how to define a genocide and in what cases the world should intervene in the domestic affairs of a country to stop these atrocities. The essential question asks about causes and consequences, so you could look at those in more detail and see the extent to which they are caused by ethnic or religious conflict, by a lack of an effective international response, essentially by letting dictators who carry on this sort of attacks get away with it. In some cases, it's the type of military strategy. In other cases, it's a political conflict within a country for supremacy. Of course, we have a devastating death toll, a lack of individual freedom, and the perpetuation of discrimination and stereotypes. So the essential question for the unit asks for the relative significance of the causes of global conflicts. Remember, here's those two global conflicts, and we have this sort of complex chart here. So if you look at 7.1 and 7.2 together, they are causes of World War I. Some of that political instability, especially in the case of the Ottoman Empire, I wouldn't argue that Mexico's socialist government is a cause of World War I, but the events in the Ottoman Empire are. Remember, we had those main causes. So we have World War I happening, and that has an effect of mass casualties and total war. It also breaks up European empires, and of course we have those terms of the Treaty of Versailles. Together with what we see in 7.4 and 6, the global depression, the rise of fascism and political aggression, such as the expansion of Germany, we have those things collectively causing World War II. World War II also sees mass casualties and total war, and the immediate effect that we look at in 7.8 are those global atrocities, and we'll look in Unit 8 at a new global political landscape, such as the Cold War. In the theme video, we'll look in more detail at this idea of the relative significance. And what we'll do is we'll sort those causes by our historical themes. But that'll be in the theme video. For now, that's your Unit 7 content overview. Happy studying!